Finally, with the release of Java 21, we have an LTS version with something ready to use from Project Loom. Loom aims to bring an easy-to-use new programming model on the Java platform, but for now, with JDK 21, we get lightweight concurrency. Virtual threads are a different approach to asynchronous programming. Other languages like C#, Python, JavaScript, C++, Rust choose to add new keywords like async await, requiring a significant rewrite of the code to take advantage of this model. Java choose to maintain code compatibility and minimize the impact on existing code to benefit from this model. To avoid confusion, we now have more descriptive name for threads. Platform threads are the good old threads that are typically mapped to kernel threads, and they are managed by the operating system. We can still use the old way to create a thread by creating an instance of the thread class, passing a runnable, or we can use the new builder method with the unstarted and start variant to create a thread. Platform threads are general purpose, but they are a bit heavy if you spin them up to run short tasks, and the executor service was introduced to solve that problem by allowing you to submit tasks to a queue and having a pool of threads executing them, removing the overhead of thread startup and avoiding you to implement thread pooling. Unfortunately, if you have tasks taking a long time to be executed, you're blocking everyone, and creating tons of thread have a cost. In most backend services, slow tasks are generally IO-bound tasks, waiting for another service to respond, and this waiting time is CPU wasted. Completable Future tried to solve that, but the way they did was pushing the IO task to another thread, giving you the ability to exit your function and let another task run. If you're using JavaNet HTTP client with the default executor, for each send async request, a new thread will be created, and that thread is only waiting for the response. Virtual threads are a solution to eliminate the overhead from IO-bound tasks. They are user mode threads scheduled by the Java runtime, and they are meant to be used with IO-bound tasks. Later, we will see code examples of what happens when used with CPU-bound tasks. To use virtual threads, you don't have to change anything. Java did all the work underneath, making all the IO methods cooperating with the virtual thread scheduler. The API is more or less the same as the one for the platform threads. There is a new executor service that allowed you to submit tasks using virtual threads, and if you want to manually create them, you have a simple method, start virtual threads, taking a runnable, or you can just use the new builder method. As you can see, a thread class represents both a platform and a virtual thread. There is now an isVirtual method telling you if a thread instance is a virtual or not, and if you print the thread name or use JStack, you'll see that the platform thread have not changed the representation and that the virtual thread have an extra piece saying runnable at fork join pool. These lead us to carrier thread, which are a set of platform threads responsible for running virtual threads. Under the hood, a fork join pool is used, with a first in, first out queue order, and there are a couple of system properties that you can set to increase or decrease parallelism. The main difference with the traditional executor service is that when a running virtual thread reaches a blocking operation, like an IO, a sleep, or a yield, the virtual thread will be unmounted from the carrier thread, copying the stack of the running task to the heap. The task goes to a waiting queue and it stays there until the blocking operation is complete. When completed, the virtual thread will be placed back into the execution queue, and a free carrier thread will mount the virtual thread, copying back the previously saved execution stack, resuming the code from where it was with all the state. This means that each execution step of a task running in a virtual thread may run on a different carrier thread, and the larger the stack, the more memory virtual thread will use. Thread locals are available for compatibility, but since you should not pool virtual threads, they are not really useful. What you may want is a thread local on the carrier thread. Unfortunately, at the moment, there is no provided construct. Scoped values are supposed to do that, but they are still in preview on JDK 21. Let's see how virtual thread behaves with some code examples. In this example, our task will call a service that will take 5 seconds to respond. As you can see, the code is using the synchronous.send method of the HTTP client. No callbacks, future, or other stuff that make code hard to read. Let's use the virtual thread per task executor and submit 10 tasks. And let's reduce the parallelism of the virtual thread scheduler for these examples. If we measure the completion time from the demo start time, we will see that each task completes in 5 seconds. Not because a lot of threads were created, but because after calling send, the task was put in a waiting queue, allowing the other task to also send a request. On request completion, each task got resumed and mounted to the first available carrier. If we replace the HTTP request with another blocking operation like sleep, we will get the same behavior. We can also manually create virtual threads and the result will be the same. Virtual threads are made for IO-bound tasks, but let's see how they will behave with a CPU-bound task. The task will increment a counter for 5 seconds. System nanotime is not considered a blocking operation, so there are no blocking points in the code to unmount the virtual thread. So once the execution starts, the virtual thread will stay on the same carrier thread until completion. Let's start 10 tasks with a parallelism reduced to 2 to understand better what is going on. Again, the result will be the same using both the virtual thread executor service or starting manually the virtual threads. 2 tasks at a time will be executed, giving us 5, 10, 15 seconds and so on completion times. Virtual threads here give you no advantage, and they're basically the same as using a standard executor service. The problem is that if you have a mix of CPU-bound and IO-bound tasks running on virtual threads, IO-bound tasks will have to wait running and pending CPU-bound tasks in front to complete, eliminating the benefits of virtual threads. You should send CPU-bound tasks to dedicated executors and leave virtual threads only for IO-bound tasks. If your CPU-bound task is willing to cooperate with other tasks, you can leverage the yield method to let other tasks run. Let's use the same CPU-bound task, but inserting every once in a while an explicit yield. That will allow the carrier thread to unmount the virtual thread, and the result will be that all the tasks will complete in around 5 seconds. If you don't have a time-bounded task like this one, each task will take longer to execute than if they are executed alone. But that is the same behavior of starting one thread for each task and letting the operating system schedule them. One thing to be aware is that virtual threads don't play well with synchronized methods. Synchronized is going to block the carrier threads, and it doesn't matter if the task has blocking operation or not. For this example, let's create 4 objects to synchronize on, and use the task ID to identify which object to use as lock. In this way, if you are lucky, different carrier thread will take a different object to synchronize on. But even assuming we are lucky, we get the same behavior of a CPU-bound task. And if we are unlucky, all the carrier threads will be blocked waiting for a single object lock to release. Removing the synchronized usage is one of the very few changes that libraries and various codebases will have to fix to fully leverage virtual threads. A solution is to use a proper locking mechanism like reentrant locks, semaphores, or reiterate locks. In this code, we just replaced the synchronized keyword with the lock and lock of reentrant lock. And now we will be sure that 4 tasks will run concurrently, and other virtual threads can also be executed. This because locks are implemented as blocking operation, allowing the carrier thread to unmount the task, allowing others to be executed. This example should give you an idea on how to leverage virtual threads, keeping in mind that you should not go and replace all your executor service to use virtual threads. CPU-bound tasks will not benefit from it, and the extra logic for mount-unmount will probably make the execution a bit slower. Virtual threads should be used for IO-bound tasks. But even if now you can run a million concurrent tasks, you should probably think twice about it. Your current code is probably making just a few concurrent requests to other services, database, disk, and similar. If you start forwarding all your traffic to the other service, you should make sure that it is able to handle the extra load. And you should probably reconsider the current configuration and tunings of those services. In general, it is better if you can control how many requests are you going to forward. So you should think about having a semaphore or something similar to restrict the number of virtual threads that can concurrently access a resource. Virtual threads are just the beginning. Project Loom has a lot more stuff coming in the next releases, from fix to the current implementation shortcomings like replacing thread locals with scoped values, to make easier writing code with a new programming model. So stay tuned for structured concurrency and more. As always, if you have any questions or want to know more, leave a comment below.